Russell Harper. I know a lot of y'all, I'm a businessman for electricians local here in Jacksonville. IBW 177, which is International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, went on record for supporting, I'm going to go ahead and call him Senator Grayson, because he understands, the reality of the issues that face working class men and women in this country. I'm not just talking union members, I'm talking about all workers. You know, he didn't come from a rich family like some of his opposition. He understands how important unions are for the protection of all workers, again, not just union workers, and that the right to organize and be represented by a union is under attack by most of the legislators that are there now. He understands the importance of unions from his own family upbringing and for the fact that he's an American Federation of Government Employees union member, I think since he was about 18 years old.
Correct.
He defends the right for union workers to have living wages, decent benefits, and fully understands that the pensions of the working men and women of this country are being attacked by a lot of the legislators. He understands that helping protect these basic rights for union workers also protects rights for all workers. He's been in the forefront to protect the workers from bad trade bills, to fight for against wage theft by unscrupulous employers, and he co-sponsored the Employee Free Choice Act that would be very beneficial for the survival of unions and all workers. He understands the impact of the Davis-Bacon Act, and a lot of y'all may not know what Davis-Bacon is, but it guarantees wages that are standard in the section where the work is. That's also under attack. So he's all for fighting that for everybody. It would be extremely beneficial to have someone in the Senate that does even know what it is. And we'll support workers' right to living wages and benefits. Too many of our unfriendly legislators would prefer to strip Davis-Bacon, having us all work for nothing, which when the unions work for less, generally everybody else works for less. As our senator, Mr. Grayson, will fight to preserve the protections the union have for workers, as well as to increase pro-labor policies. As a senator, he will also be able to help the senior citizens. He understands that many seniors are not fortunate enough to have pensions. He would be able, in a position to increase Social Security benefits and make sure that Medicare covers the needs of the people that are on it. This includes vision and dental, ear care, prescription coverage. Just as important, he would fight to keep Social Security solvent without any cuts to those that need it so badly and paid in it for so many years in their working lives. Jacksonville, like many cities, do have an aging population. It needs someone like Senator Grayson to protect the benefits they have and to make those benefits actually help the seniors as Social Security was intended to in its inception. And with that, I introduce our next senator, Alan Grayson. Yeah.
Talk about, but I want to tell you some union stories because my friend did such a great job introducing me here, my friend from the IBEW, the Electrical Workers. A few years ago, we got the huge construction project to build a new VA hospital in Orlando. I wasn't in office at the time, the Republicans had defeated me, and then I was re-elected 2 years later. That's another story. But they issued the contract without what's called a PLA, Project Labor Agreement, and the result of that is that there weren't any union workers on site. And the thing quickly became a nightmare. They were underpaying people, not paying people. The subcontractors were walking off the job. The work wasn't being done to spec. And this is what happens when you don't have unions involved. The unions make everything kosher. And it wasn't happening. So three members of the IBW got into the back of my car. I drove over to the work site. They had a heavily secure perimeter with barbed wire for some reason. Building a VA hospital with barbed wire. I went up to the guard post and I said, Congressman Grayson here, I need to go inside. I said, oh, fine, okay, no problem. So the three of them in the back, as soon as we were inside the perimeter, they opened the door and went off in three different directions, found so many labor violations that it became the most fined work site in the history of Central Florida. This is actually true. And it was all because three of my friends from the IBEW were willing to sit in the back of my car while I went through that perimeter and make them do it right. That's one thing. Secondly, I well remember the effort to organize the largest McDonald's in America, that happens to be in Orlando, near Universal Studios. We went sat aside on the street because we couldn't get inside on private property. We went outside on the street with signs, this is when I was a member of Congress, trying to organize the workers at this McDonald's. This is the UFCW doing this. And they turned on the sprinklers and soaked us all. So the newspapers had some fun with that. Congressman Grayson gets soaked. But that's not the worst thing that happened. The worst thing that happened was one Thanksgiving, when we worked with the UFCW, the food and commercial workers, to try to organize Walmart. Now, there's never been any Walmart in the United States that's ever been organized. There was one that was organized in Canada, and they shut it down as soon as it was organized. They just shut the whole store down and moved away. So that's a real tough nut to crack. They had people working on Thanksgiving night. No overtime pay, no time and a half overtime. Just working on Thanksgiving night, regular hours, no extra pay. So some of my UFCW labor friends and I went into the Walmart in my district, and we started handing out paper bags to all the workers who were there. It was Thanksgiving night, so naturally we had a turkey sandwich inside the bag, and a bag of chips, and a letter about how to form a union. Well, I was escorted roughly off the premises. The hate radio stations had a field day the next day. Congressman gets arrested at Walmart, blah, 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 blah. But sometimes you got to stand up for what's right. You got to stand up for what's right. But that's why when I returned to Congress, well, actually when I was first elected to Congress in 2009, I contacted the AFGE. I'd not been a member of the AFGE actively for many years because I joined when I was 18 years old, but then I went off and did other things. And I said, I would like to reinstate my membership in the AFGE. And they said, what do you mean? I said, well, I get the same paycheck you do. I've got the Statue of Liberty on a green paycheck every month. That's the kind you get too. And they said, geez, nobody ever asked that before. Aren't you management? I said, I don't feel like management. I don't think that I'm management. I said, okay, fine. So I got to rejoin the AFGE when I was elected to Congress in 2009. I wanted to just give you a little bit of background, but what I really want to talk about is the election. I'd love to talk to you about a million things, but the election is getting really close, so we have to concentrate here. And I want you to understand how I see this. I want this election to be about something, and that's something new. For years now, we've been forced to choose between the lesser of two evils over and over and over again. And it's just not fair to the public. You know, everybody goes negative on everybody else, and people aren't left with any sense that they could actually do that wonderful thing in democracy called improving your lives through voting. And that's what this election is really all about, okay? I can guarantee you that if we have this election, and it's on the basis of who is better looking, I will lose. In fact, it doesn't matter who my opponents are. I'm pretty sure that if it's on the basis of who is better looking, I will lose. All right? But that's not the way this works. We're not choosing the captain of the football team. We're not choosing the homecoming queen. We're choosing the people who actually make our laws. And people now need to be reminded of that fact. Now, I've done my best to try to remind them in the most practical way possible, which is to get good things done. Good things done for ordinary people. And I'm in a special position to do that because I'm the only member of the House of Representatives who raised most of his campaign funds through small contributions. Now, did you hear me? There are 435 members of the U.S. Congress, and 434 of them are on the take. Okay? They get most of their campaign funds from billionaires and from multinational corporations and from lobbyists and from special interests and from PACs. That's where we are, folks. That's where we are. But thanks to 150,000 contributors to our campaign, thanks to enough volunteers so that in the last election, In the last election, we had 62,000 volunteer phone calls in one day.
Whoa.
Did you hear me? 62,000 volunteer phone calls in one day. Thanks to that people power, I'm in a position, a unique position, to do the people's business. To be unbought and unbossed, and actually to do the greatest good for the greatest number. That's what makes this campaign unique. Now, a lot of people say, this campaign, this is the undercard to the presidential campaign. Why? Well, for one thing, could determine the control of the Senate. That's possible. For another thing, it's in a state that always can go either way. I'm figuring I'm going to either win by 3 votes or lose by 3 votes. That's about it.
Recount.
That's the way things work. And there'll be a recount. That's right. But most importantly, this is our last best chance to elect someone with a conscience to the U.S. Senate.
Amen.
This is our last best chance. Elect somebody who's going to go all out for justice, equality, and peace. Justice, equality, and peace.
Yes.
Justice, equality, and peace. Justice, equality, and peace. Thank you. Now, I've got good news and I've got bad news, okay? The good news is we've demonstrated that we can actually get good things done. All right? In the last 3 years, I've written more bills than any other member of the House of Representatives. Why? Because I don't have to spend 15 hours a day begging rich people for money. Okay? And I've passed more amendments than any other member of the House of Representatives, Democratic or Republican. You think about how hard that is. Every time there's a party line vote, I lose. Every single time. And nevertheless, I've passed more amendments than any other Democrat or Republican. Good, solid, progressive amendments. I'll give you one example. We moved $71 million from the military budget to the health research budget. That's my example. Twenty-six Grayson bills were passed by the House, passed by the Senate, and are now the law of the land. Does anybody want to guess how many bills my primary opponent has passed through the House that
Zero.
He wrote? Zero! That's right, zero! That's exactly right. Yes, and Time magazine said that I'm a standout member in a do-nothing Congress. They were right on both accounts. That's right. So, we've demonstrated the concept here. The idea that if you are actually independent, if you get elected through people power, you can actually get good things done, even in a Republican-controlled House that's been on lockdown for the past 3 years. That's the way it's been. They don't want to get anything done, and yet we've passed around 70 amendments. 70 amendments! That's one every 2 weeks. And we've passed 26 bills through the House of Representatives, through the Senate, signed into law by the President. We can get good things done. All right, now the bad news is that because of that, the other side is putting their bottom dollar into this race against us. Okay? My primary opponent has raised more money from Wall Street than any Democrat in the House of Representatives because he's against me. Okay? Now, let me tell you exactly what the backstory is here, all right? When I was first elected, I was the first freshman in 2009 to pass a bill for the House of Representatives. I did it in 9 days. It's called the Pay for Performance Act, and it prohibited Wall Street from taking bailout money and using it to stuff their pockets. Imagine how they felt about that. They were deeply disappointed in me. I seemed like such a promising young man until that point. And then it got worse. Then I lined up 100 Democrats to support a bill that had never even gotten a hearing before, Ron Paul's bill to audit the Federal Reserve.
Hey!
That's right. The most watched video in the history of the U.S. Congress is my examination of the Inspector General, Elizabeth Coleman. More than 5 million people have watched that video. They watch all 5 minutes of it. That's such a remarkable thing. You can't even get people to watch 5 minutes of porn anymore. And as a result of that and other things that we did, I lined up 100 Democrats to go along with the Republicans and put Ron Paul's bill into law, and we found $23 trillion of bailouts that hadn't been disclosed. $23 trillion of bailouts. That's more than America's gross national product. They actually had given $4,000 to every single person in New Zealand. In New Zealand. You might say, well, where was my bailout? Good question. So Wall Street is not our friends. My primary opponent, who has only been in Congress for 3 years, okay? He does sit on the banking committee, but he's not a ranking member of any committee. He's not a ranking member of any subcommittee. And yet he's raised much more than the chairman of the committee, who's a Republican. And he's raised more than anybody in Congress from Wall Street, except for the Speaker and the majority leader, both Republicans. He's number three overall, number one among the Democrats. That shows what we're up against. We are up against the force of big money. Big money.
Lobbyists.
But in the last poll, we're up by three.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, we have to lock this down. We are going to be seeing a tsunami of dirty money coming at us in the next 51 days. All right? He's already purchased $1.7 million of TV and radio time. Some of his ads are airing on the radio here already in this city. You know, I see somebody nodding. You've heard them, right? He sounds like everybody's best pal. He is lobbyist's best pal. To show you how deep he is in with them, we had a 43-day recess last year. We didn't have to be in Washington, D.C. for 43 days. His first day back, he had dinner with Goldman Sachs. I'm not kidding. Okay, that's how deep he is in with them.
Did he get paid for it?
Well,
did he ever release
it? Yes, with a nice $10,000 fact check. That's how they always get paid for it. They bundled for him, too. He just from Goldman Sachs alone, he raised over almost $50,000. Just from Goldman Sachs. And I'm talking about last year and this year alone.
Did he ever release his transcripts?
So we can win. We are winning. We are winning. Okay? But we have to fight his money power, his propaganda power, his lying power, with our people power and the power of truth. If every single Florida voter in our Democratic primary on August 30th gets three polls from this campaign, we will win. We will win. But I need an awful lot of help. An awful lot of help to make that happen. So what do we get out of this? Well, I'll tell you. Seniors deserve a raise. Mm-hmm. When you call people on behalf of this campaign, if they're any older than me, I'm 58, what I want them to hear is seniors deserve a raise. And I mean it, okay? I spent more than 20 years of my life starting the Alliance for Aging Research and then being an officer of the Alliance for Aging Research and increasing health research for seniors by 500%. That was me, all right? I was also a director of Florida Senior Programs. Just last week, one of my 70 amendments was to increase free tax advice for seniors by 50%. And when they were gonna brutally cut, the Florida Seniors Housing Program and housing around the state and the nation, I got them to reverse that. I forced a vote and I backed off. I said, okay, you got us. We're not going to cut that account because we don't want to have to vote to show people that we're cutting that account. And my seniors have Eyes, Ears, and Teeth Act to extend Medicare to cover eyes, ears, and teeth now has 175 co-sponsors out of 435 members. Even some of the Republicans see some value in that. So we're going to... We're not just going to protect Medicare, we're going to expand Medicare. We're not just going to protect Social Security, we're going to expand Social Security. It's been 40 years since there was any increase in Social Security benefits. This year there wasn't even a cost of living adjustment. I asked the Congressional Research Service, what should they have done if they did it straight up? You know what they did? They made the cost of living adjustment dependent upon how working people spend their money. I said, excuse me, don't you realize that a lot of seniors are retirees? Don't you get that? Sorry, that's the way we were told to do it 40 years ago. So in fact, they're calculating the cost of living adjustments based upon how people who aren't seniors spend their money. I said to them, if you calculated it right, what would it have been? And they said, an extra $25 billion. $25 billion with a B. So my senior Zero-Raise Act, which has about 100 co-sponsors, fixes that problem forever. Gives seniors the money they've been cheated out of, $388 billion cumulatively. Gives seniors the money they've been cheated out of, and makes sure it never happens again. My seniors have Eyes, Ears, and Teeth Act, does what it says, extends Medicare to cover eyes, ears, and teeth. Nobody even knows anymore why these things are excluded in Medicare. It was in the original bill. We asked, is there any legislative history? Well, we don't know. Who did it? We don't know. How did it get in there? We don't know. We have to fix this problem. There's 2.8 million blind seniors in this country. How many of them would be able to see today if they've gotten a $40 eye test that the government is prohibited from paying for? And the only bill that fixes Social Security forever is the Grayson bill. We've had it scored by the Social Security Administration. They say that the way we do it is the right way to do it. The way I explain it to people is this. LeBron James stops paying his Social Security tax in the beginning of the second quarter of the first game he plays each season. He doesn't pay any tax for the rest of the game, not the next 81 games, not the playoffs either. He's done. Once you reach $118,000 a year, you stop. You don't have to pay any more. Well, my scrap the cap bill fixes that problem the right way, and according to Social Security, it makes it solvent forever and ever. So we can stop. And give seniors the peace of mind that they have earned through hard work for half a century. And the last Grayson bill for seniors is actually not a Grayson bill for seniors. One of my colleagues, a Republican, put in a brilliant one-page bill that eliminates the double taxation of Social Security. You pay taxes when you pay in, and then you pay taxes when it pays out to you. What else is like that? Nothing else is like that. There's no reason why you should have to pay taxes twice. So I picked up a bill from a Republican, a good, solid Republican bill, and I co-sponsored, and now we're walking around trying to get Democrats and Republicans to join in that bill, to eliminate the double taxation of Social Security benefits. That is the Grayson Seniors platform. Now, the organization that I helped to start, the Alliance for Aging Research, gives out an award each year to the elected official who has done the most for seniors. We call it the Claude Pepper Award. How many of you know Claude Pepper? Raise your hand. Okay. Since he died in 1989, we really have not had a champion for seniors in the state of Florida or anywhere really around the country. I want to win that award. When you call people about this election, and they're my age or older, I want them to hear that. I want them to hear the good things that we've done for seniors already, and the even more important good things we're going to do to give seniors peace of mind that they deserve. Say it after me. Seniors deserve a raise.
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 Now, I don't want it to sound like that's the only thing on my mind. I've been a champion for universal health care. I was a sick child when I was growing up. Both of my parents belonged to the UFT, the teachers union in New York. I had to go to the hospital four times a week for treatment when I was growing up. And when they went on strike, which was frequently, they went on strike very frequently when I was growing up. Two long strikes, five short ones. I was a strike baby. The only reason why I'm standing before you today and able to talk about this is that the union paid the health benefits when we went on strike. So everyone must be able to see a doctor when he or she is sick and get the care that they need to stay healthy and alive. We want to reach a point that other countries reached, Germany in the 1880s, where everybody gets the care they need to stay healthy and alive. And we desperately need work to pay. We need people to be able to support themselves if they work full time, and even their families. Michael Moore has documented the destruction of the middle class in America. We've gone from a country where an ordinary job used to give you a house, a car, a pension, health coverage, and some possibility of paying your children's college tuition. Now that is disappearing, or for many people has disappeared. The minimum wage must be $15 an hour or more. It must be. Everyone should be able to enjoy paid sick leave. I actually paid to put paid sick leave on the ballot in my county, Orange County, and it won with 62% of the vote, and then the Republicans in Tallahassee took it away from us through preemption. We are the only major country in the world without paid sick leave. We're the only major country in the world without paid vacations. We have to make sure that we reward an honest day's work with an honest day's pay. And over time, what we must do is make sure that we have every form of social equality, economic equality, racial equality, generational equality, and equality. Now, we've seen some hard times here locally. I'm not going to get into the specifics because everybody here knows what I'm talking about. There's been enormous amounts of friction between law enforcement and ordinary citizens. And we've seen a lot of lives ended prematurely. I'm involved in one case locally already. We had a tragic situation that came up in Tampa, which, by the way, is nowhere near my district, where a 14-year-old boy at a state fair was watching his friends be arrested. They arrested them for screaming too loudly and for running through the fair. They called it wilding. His friend's hat fell off. 14-year-old boy went over and picked up his friend's hat. Police officer said, "I didn't say you to do that. You're under arrest." African-American 14-year-old white police officer. According to the reports I've read, every police officer that went to the fair that night was white. Every single boy that they arrested was black. Every single one. Made him strip to the waist, so they were looking for gang colors. Pushed him into a police car, drove him 2 miles away to a neighborhood he'd never seen before in his entire life, and threw him out of the car. And it's a 14-year-old boy who had a phone in his pocket, but he's saying to himself, "I've been arrested. Do I really want my mother to know about this? I've been stripped to the waist. Do I really want my mother to know about this?" So he found his way back to the fair where his father was supposed to pick him up. Didn't quite make it, though. Tried to cross the interstate. He got killed. His father came to the fair that night and said to the police, "Where's my boy? Where's my boy? Where's my boy?" One of the officers says, "What's his telephone number?" Called the telephone number. It rang in the dead boy's body on Interstate 4. That's how he found out that his son was dead. So I have asked the FBI to investigate racial profiling in town.
Absolutely.
We will see what happens. We have a lot of unforced errors going on, to put it as plainly and nicely as possible. There's an awful lot of people who are dead who ought to be alive. I talked about this on the floor of the House, and I pointed out that I happen to know the family of a 16-year-old white girl who lives on the other side of Florida. She's on the Atlantic coast. And when she was drinking with her boyfriend in his car, which is definitely illegal, okay? That's definitely illegal. The police came, and they didn't arrest anybody. They just called up her mother and said, "Your daughter's here with us, come and get her." She lived that night, and poor Andrew is dead. But the problems, let's face it, they go a lot deeper than that. We live in a country where if Andrew Joseph III in Tampa had lived, being a black 14-year-old, he would have had almost no chance of going to college. 18% of African Americans go to college, 29% of whites. If he joined the workforce, worked for a living, he would have made a lot less money. The average income in black families in America is $38,000. The average income for white families is $58,000. There's a $20,000 poll tax in America these days called being black. And even life itself is shorter. If you're an African-American man, you live for 74 years. If you're a white man, you live for 79 years. So you tell me, what's actually worse? Stealing 50 years of life from one boy? Or 5 years of life from 40 million? These are real problems that we really have to face. They're not going to solve themselves. We have to do something to actually solve them. You know, when I was growing up, we used to dream of this idea that we have a colorblind society. That a famous man once said, you'd be judged not by the color of your skin, but by the content of your character. Well, 50 years have passed. His children are the same age as me. One of them's already passed away, gone. And the others are still waiting, just like I am. We're not a colorblind society, we are a racism-blind society. and we need to make tangible efforts to change that. I will say this as gently as I can. It's not enough to have an African-American president. It's not enough. We have to heal this country. Are you with me?
Yes. Yes.
Are you with me?
Yes.
Are you with me?
Yes.
Then let's win.
Gentlemen, my name is Ben Weaver, but everyone knows me as Ben America.
Woo!
As I'm very fortunate to have the opportunity to organize in my home district because the congressman believes in building capacity for the progressive movement. Look around you. I've called many of you on the phone, and I said, we're calling progressives today in Northeast Florida, and you said, you're making more than one dial? Well, guess what? We have progressives in Northeast Florida.
Yeah.
If you look up on the wall, you'll see these numbers around the room, 36 and 51. People have been asking me since they've gotten here today, Ben, what do those numbers mean? We have 36 days in Duval County before early voting starts. It starts August 15th. We have 51 days until we can finally cast all of these votes and elect Senator Grayson to the the primary to run against whoever the Republicans decide to put up. What we're looking for today is for people who can get five of their friends, colleagues, relatives, or just random strangers on the streets to sign a pledge that they will vote for Alan Grayson.
Yeah.
Who here can do that? Let me see any show of hands. All right. Before you leave, our organizers are in the room. They are ready to hand you five pledge cards. Now, I know where all of those pledge cards are going. Don't ask me how. It's the magic of technology. But when you walk out of here, you should be walking out of here with five pledge cards because you've already filled one out. Has everyone here signed in and filled out a pledge card?
Yes.
Excellent. I need you to sign in because Orlando had 75 people at their grand opening, and I'm looking around and I'm thinking, Jacksonville may have beat Orlando. But I won't know that unless you sign in, so please make sure you do that. We're going to send you with the pledge cards, and then we've got phone bank shifts listed on the wall here. Those shifts on the wall happen every day because I'm here from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. Monday through Monday. You got that? Monday through Monday.
7 days.
Now, we were smart and decided to wait until the congressman spoke to bring you food so that you'll hang around and get to know each other. Make sure you get to know each other. We've got some amazing folks here. Labor is represented today. The LGBT community is represented today. Our African American brothers and sisters who are out marching for Black Lives Matter. Let's come together and let's build this movement and let's take this seat. Thank you.
Yeah.